Random House Audio presents Soldier, The Life of Colin Powell by Karen DeYoung. Read for you by Roscoe Orman. At precisely 5 p.m. on September 19, 2005, students and faculty bustling along the sidewalks of the National War College stopped and stood at attention as the notes from a solitary bugle drifted by on a breeze. The crisp cadences of the ceremonial retreat, signaling the official end of the day, were a quotidian reminder that this bucolic campus beside the Potomac River in Washington, D.C., was no ordinary seat of higher learning. Located inside a military installation, Fort Leslie J. McNair, it was surrounded by high red brick walls and protected by armed guards at every gate. The War College had been established at the end of World War II as an institution devoted as much to the avoidance of war as to its practice. Its students were drawn from among the most promising mid-level officers in the armed forces, but also from the Department of State, in recognition of diplomacy's critical role in keeping the nation secure. Warriors and diplomats studied side by side, learning from the great strategists in both their fields. On this September evening, the college was celebrating its 60th anniversary with a speech by its most distinguished graduate, retired general and former Secretary of State Colin Luther Powell. As the last bugle note sounded, those on their way to Powell's 5:30 address resumed their journey toward Roosevelt Hall, an imposing neoclassical building on the waterfront. The summer of 2005 was also an anniversary for Powell himself. It marked 30 years since he had arrived on campus as a 38-year-old lieutenant colonel in the Army infantry. At the time, the New York City-born son of Jamaican immigrants was well on his way to a brilliant career with two tours in Vietnam, a stint in the Pentagon, and a prestigious White House fellowship under his belt. If he fulfilled the promise that more senior officers saw in him, he could expect to retire after 35 years of service with two or more general stars on his shoulders. He would be one of only a handful of black officers to have risen to such heights. Powell ultimately soared beyond even his own dreams, becoming National Security Advisor to one president and chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the military's highest office, under two more. He brought the U.S. military through the end of the Cold War and guided it to victory in the Persian Gulf War in 1991. By the time he retired from the Army in 1993, his face was known throughout the world. When President-elect George W. Bush selected Powell as his Secretary of State in December 2000, it was hailed as a stroke of genius. For Powell, it was the seamless melding of soldier and statesman that the National War College had been established to create. Since leaving the State Department in January 2005, Powell had traveled the lecture circuit, making paid speeches to corporate boards and industry conventions. Audiences often asked about his public role in promoting and defending the March 2003 invasion of Iraq. Powell had thrown his personal and professional reputation behind the administration's charges that Iraq possessed chemical, biological, and perhaps even nuclear weapons. In a crucial speech to the United Nations Security Council 6 weeks before the invasion was launched, he had convinced many skeptical Americans that the threat posed by Iraqi dictator Saddam Hussein was real. But the war had gone sour almost from the moment U.S. troops rolled into Baghdad, and after 2.5 years, there was still no end in sight. Powell's credibility had been seriously undermined when the threatening weapons he cited as the main justification for invasion turned out not to exist. No one in his legions of admirers wanted to believe that Powell had been duped by the White House, or worse yet, that he had knowingly betrayed the nation's trust. Many assumed that he had argued against such a clearly misguided adventure and had been overruled. In fact, Powell had never advised against the Iraq invasion, although he had warned Bush of the difficulties and counseled patience. But the larger mystery of his tenure as Secretary of State remained. For 4 years, he had found himself entrenched in regular combat with conservative ideologues, including the vice president and the secretary of defense. He had been purposely cut out of major foreign policy decisions more than once. His advice had often gone unheeded or been only grudgingly accepted by the president. Why hadn't he resigned? The easy answer had the virtue of truth. Soldiers didn't quit when they disagreed with the decisions of their commanders. The fact that he had been out of uniform since 1993 was irrelevant to Powell. He would be a soldier until he drew his last breath. On Thursday, November 4th, 2 days after winning 51% of the vote against Democratic challenger Senator John F. Kerry, Bush told reporters at a White House news conference that he was heading to Camp David. Over a three-day weekend with National Security Advisor Condoleezza Rice and White House Chief of Staff Andrew Carr Jr., he intended to begin the process of thinking about the cabinet and the White House staff. When he returned the following Monday, Bush's first announcement was that Card would be staying in his job. On Tuesday, the White House announced two resignations, Secretary of Commerce Donald Evans and Attorney General John Ashcroft. On Wednesday, November 10th, Powell received a telephone call from the White House. The caller was not Bush, but Card, and he got right to the point. The president would like to make a change, he said, using a time-honored formulation that avoided the words resign or fire. Bush wanted Powell's resignation letter, dated Friday, November 12th, Card said, although the White House expected him to stay at the State Department until his successor could be confirmed by the Senate. The president himself made no contact with Powell. As instructed, Powell handed his resignation letter to Card on Friday. That evening, he informed Grant Green and Mark Grossman, his undersecretaries of management and policy, and his own chief of staff, Lawrence Wilkerson, although he kept from them the details of Card's call. After his inelegant dismissal as Secretary of State, he wanted to control the way his departure was announced. He put together a plan. He would inform his inner office staff at exactly 8:20 a.m. on Monday, November 15th. He would tell his other senior aides at their regular 8:30 staff meeting. At 10:15, he would send an email to his friends and extended family. He called Card and told him he expected the White House would then publicly announce his resignation. At mid-morning Monday, the White House released five separate statements under Bush's name, reporting the resignations of the Secretaries of Agriculture, Energy, Education, and State, and the head of the Republican National Committee. The next morning, Bush nominated Condoleezza Rice to replace Powell as Secretary of State. Powell saw Bush regularly over the next 2 months for official meetings that took place as if nothing had transpired. Eventually, the White House contacted Wilkerson to schedule what it described as a farewell call with the president. As the date approached, Card's office asked the State Department to provide talking points to prepare the president for the meeting. For Wilkerson, the request was the last straw. "There was no way we were going to provide talking points," he later recalled. If the president of the United States couldn't have his principal cabinet officer call on him after 4 years in office and think of something to say, it was a disgrace. I even hung up on one of them. Seeing the meeting scheduled on his calendar, Powell asked his staff about its purpose. It was just a farewell call, he was told. The appointed time found Powell already at the White House for a routine meeting. When it concluded, he lingered in the Oval Office. As Powell later remembered it, Bush seemed puzzled and called after his chief of staff, "Where are you going, Andy?" "Mr. President, I think this is supposed to be our farewell call," Powell prompted. "Is that why Condi ain't here?" Over 4 years, Rice had almost always been present when Powell met with the president. "That was probably the reason," Powell replied. Card walked back inside, and the three men sat down. Powell had already decided to use the opportunity to unload. The war in Iraq was going south, he said, and the president had little time left to turn it around. The administration's hope was that the upcoming election would change the dynamics on the ground, and the Iraqi people would finally begin standing up to the insurgents on their own. But the administration had entertained such hopes before over the past 2 years, when it had set up a new legal framework for Iraq, when it had first turned a modicum of government power over to hand-picked Iraqis, and when ousted dictator Saddam Hussein had been captured, and they had been dashed every time. Elections and talking about democracy were unlikely to stop the insurgency, Powell said. Only the fledgling Iraqi army could do that, and it was unclear whether it would ever succeed. Its competence was not just a matter of training, Powell said. It was a question of whether the troops believed in what they were fighting for. They were no different from American soldiers, who fought because they believed in their institutions and in their country, and their civilian and military leaders. And when that belief vanished, as it had in Vietnam, the going got tough. Powell's last-minute intervention appeared to have little impact on the president.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.